What up, what up, what up, everyone? Happy Friday. Welcome to Happy Hour. We did it. We made it through another week. It does seem like a little bit of a short week this week because I was out for most of the week in Idaho, but here we are. We have made it. And who's ready to drink some beer? I have a glorious, glorious, glorious like selection of beer today. And I'm actually really excited because in addition to the four craft beers that I have sitting on my desk right now that you guys are going to get a chance to vote on in a second. It's a big day and I'm very excited about this and I'm not going to be drinking them right now because they're not chilled yet. But when I went to the craft beer store earlier, hang on, let me show you. I'm so happy. Because those of you who watch my happy hour streams regularly know that my favorite brewery in the whole world is Southern Tier. Southern Tier, I believe, is located in upstate New York. Southern Tier has just overall the best imperial craft beers that you can find anywhere. I don't know exactly. I know you can get them. Like, I know people have gotten them in like North Carolina. So I know you can get them a little bit farther south. I don't know how far west you can get them. But when I went to the beer store, I let out a yip of excitement, just like I was like my fucking chihuahua downstairs when she sees food getting delivered or something, because Southern Tier Mocha and the Peanut Butter Cup Imperial Stout, both of which are like 11% alcohol, are out. They are in my fridge. I'm not going to drink them tonight, but I might be drinking them tomorrow for Socialism Saturday. I'm just saying. But don't worry, we got some other great beer here because that's what we do on Happy Hour. It's Friday and we celebrate by drinking and watching Unwoke training, which is what we do almost every single day on this channel. And I got to tell you guys, I was doing some searching and, you know, it really is amazing to me. It is amazing how many lying liars there are on the internet who insist on telling people DEI is dead. DEI is dead. DEI is dead. Look, the Daily Show says DEI is dead. Do you guys want me to show you just a few of the trainings that I found today, not trying very hard? Let me show you how dead DEI is. Because guys, every single time I do searches to try to find trainings to watch on our streams, literally every single time I do it, I find more trainings than we can actually possibly watch. There is an abundance of stuff that we can watch. For example, Intuit. Intuit, does anyone recognize the name Intuit? That's a relatively big company. For those of you like me who's going to be doing your taxes in the next week, or maybe I'm going to file an extension on my taxes this year because like I just don't really feel like it. But anyway, the taxes are going to work themselves out. They always do. Intuit is the company that owns TurboTax. They own Credit Karma. They own QuickBooks and they own MailChimp. Guess what Intuit's been doing this week? They've been updating their YouTube page with sessions from their Trans Plus Summit to include Trans 101, Trans Hiring and Recruiting for Gen Z and Alpha Gen, Practical Application, and General Remarks from a Trans Influencer. But DEI is dead, huh? DEI is dead? Are you sure? Let me show you some of the other things I found. Oh, God, the University of Denver. We all know that I love Colorado because Colorado is quickly turning into one of the most socialist states in the country. The University of Denver, a couple months ago, had a whole trans seminar where they're talking about trans and non-binary bodies, affirmative action, fighting back against the Supreme Court decision, all that good stuff. That's the University of Denver. How about the University of Minnesota? Check this shit out. I almost decided to watch this today. I was like this close because you know it's going to be so woke, but it's also going to be so wonky that it's ridiculous. This is out of the University of Minnesota, so taxpayer funded. Queering Consequence, a framework for liberatory logics. And I kid you not, guys, this is a combination of philosophy and math. There are whole, in this presentation, I only scrubbed through it quickly. There are whole goddamn equations. Hopefully we can just get one pulled up here based on, you know, based on my internet actually working YouTube. But there are whole like mathematical, logical equations in this presentation to explain the need to queer our society. Like, I swear to God. And it's 2 hours long. I almost watched it. I was like, I don't even know. I don't know if I can survive that. I just don't know. But that's the University of Minnesota. AGU, this is a science university for geoscientists. Uplifting transgender and gender nonconforming geoscientists through allyship and empowerment. What does that even mean? I don't know. Do you guys know that queer geoscientists need justice too? Because there's a presentation about that. But of course, DEI is totally dead. How about the University of Michigan? Another taxpayer-funded institution. And this is not even the University of Michigan proper. This is Michigan Engineering. The Engineering College. Or department. I don't know if they're a department or a college, but this is definitely, oh, yep. The University of Michigan College of Engineering. Do you guys know what I want a taxpayer-funded engineering college teaching? Gender-inclusive allyship. I just think that makes a ton of sense. If you like, you know, like when the bridges start falling and the buildings don't last as long as we want them to, and things just start dropping out of the sky, you guys can say that you knew that the University of Michigan in the College of Engineering is teaching gender-inclusive allyship, and this was just uploaded less than a year ago. How about this one? UCLA staff. Lunch and Learn, creating a more inclusive campus for transgender and non-binary Bruins. UCLA, also taxpayer-funded. But ultimately, I landed on this one. Ultimately, this is the presentation that I have decided that we will watch today. And it's not that we didn't have many other really great options. But this is just... Like, this is one of those moments where it feels like fate intervened and the universe guided me to exactly the right presentation to watch. First off, it's called Identity Affirmation and Its Impact, Non-Binary and Transgender Identities. And in looking at the very short description, all it says is, in this session, we will discuss the mental health impact that identity affirmation has on transgender and non-binary youth. You guys know that I love nothing more than when organizations talk about gender identity for children on the internet, particularly if they're maybe including those children in the presentations. And this isn't even, you'll notice this says day two. Day two of what, you ask? Well, this seems to be part of a virtual summit 2023. So I went back on their YouTube page and sure enough, there are a whole metric ton of gender identity trainings all around this conference. Look at this one. Nothing about us without us. Youth-centered systems of care. All sorts of stuff around the psychological well-being of youth. Look at this. I really actually do want to watch this. It's called Your Story Matters, The Diary of a Schizophrenic. Does anyone want to learn about schizophrenia? It might not be the worst thing that we could do at some point. So you might be asking, what is this organization? The National Training and Technical Assistance Center for Child, Youth, and Family Mental Health. NTTAC. What is NTTAC? Well, let's keep going down the rabbit hole, because then we go to their website, which is ntaacmentalhealth.org. And it seems as though they have a lot of services for youth, doesn't it? The National Training and Technical Assistance Center for Child, Youth, and Family Mental Health works to ensure all young people and families get the support they need. NTTAC is a SAMHSA funded Initiative. Well, that seems familiar, doesn't it? SAMHSA. That seemed familiar to me, but I kept looking around their website and I went to their events section. I wanted to know what else they're doing. NTTAC offers an array of learning events at no cost to participants. Well, someone is paying the costs of these events. I scrolled down a little bit and then I found this. Pacific Southwest MHTTC. Does anyone recognize that? Does anyone recognize that partnership logo for the Pacific Southwest? MHTTC. I want to bring you back to this. When was this published? February! February 1st. When we discovered a random YouTube channel with no views on it, that had a teacher training from Orange County, California, that was federally funded, that literally said that if a kid goes into their classroom and writes, there are only two genders on the chalkboard, that's considered harassment. That was conducted. Look at that. Pacific Southwest MHTTC. Oh my word. And who's that funded by? That's funded by the Substance Abuse and Mental Health Services Administration. And who is that funded by? The U.S. Department of Health and Human Services. And if we look on their website, there it is. This is all funded by the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services. Again, another rabbit hole of federally funded gender ideology training. So congratulations, guys. We're all paying for this one. Not just the people in the crazy blue states. We're all paying for what we're going to watch today. You're welcome. You're welcome. So that's what we're going to be doing today, guys. But we do have a couple other orders of business to attend to before we get started. Now, number one, I want to congratulate James Lindsay. I think in the several months that we have been haranguing James Lindsay and reply guying James Lindsay and shit talking James Lindsay and memeing James Lindsay, even though James Lindsay has blocked my community on Twitter because James Lindsay doesn't want people looking at primary source video evidence from the real world because it contradicts what James Lindsay is telling people is going on. Even though James Lindsay has proactively flamed my community members who are some of the best researchers on the internet about what the left is doing and told people to block them, even though James Lindsay has personally shit-talked me on multiple occasions, even though I never did anything to him except try to show him what was going on and he didn't want to listen to it. It does seem as though our constant haranguing and cajoling of James Lindsay to admit that every single thing the left is doing comes back to capitalism, which is specifically defined as private property ownership, it does seem as though it's having an impact. Because I got to tell you guys, I've been seeing not just James Lindsay, but I've been seeing some influencers that I know follow my work and I know follow me on Twitter and I know secretly follow me, even if they don't want to admit it. All of a sudden, those influencers are starting to say capitalism. All of a sudden. And I was notified today because, of course, James Lindsay has me blocked on Twitter because he can't handle being questioned by a woman. But I still see everything that he posts anyway because, A, I have a sock account and I can look if I want to and there's nothing he can really do about it. B, everyone tells me what he's posting anyway. Apparently, James Lindsay wrote a 12-paragraph tryst about communism and private property. It's almost as though we're getting to him. I agree, Human Centipede. I think that this is a sign we need to double down. We need to up the meme production. Everyone needs to make a new sock account. If James has already blocked your last sock account, you make a new fucking sock account. And we got to keep on his ass because it is obvious and clear that something is moving in the right direction when James Lindsay is finally, at long last, starting to talk about how this is all about the abolition of private property and not about a fucking Gnostic sex cult. But I was also told, and I haven't read this yet, I was also told that maybe I have a little bit more of a succinct way of explaining this. Oh, well, yeah, isn't it funny that Chris Rufo, because I've been haranguing Chris Rufo too, although I've been haranguing Chris Rufo far more politely than I've been haranguing James. Isn't it funny, though, that Chris Rufo did say capitalism the other day? Chris Rufo actually posted something that looked eerily similar to what I've been saying for at least a year and a half the other day. But you know what? We're not going to worry about where he got the idea from, because clearly he didn't develop it on his own. But we're not going to worry about that. We're going to celebrate the fact that Chris Rufo is actually providing his audience with information that they need to know that is accurate and actually relatively succinct, because he blatantly copied my talking points. But we're not going to talk about that. Mm-mm. No, we're not about that. You're welcome, Chris. You're welcome. Anyway, I thought we could read what James Lindsay had to say about private property ownership and the left. And just let's just see. Thinking about squatters and history. As we all know, communism is based entirely on theft, but they wouldn't say so. They would say they understand the concept of theft correctly and no one else does. What do they believe about property? Look at that. Four sentences that could have been condensed to a couple of words. The communist view of property is that it isn't something that is owned by individuals with their right to own it secured by the government. It's that all property is commonwealth owned by the communal commonwealth. In other words, all property is communal property. Huh. Kind of sounds like what I've been trying to tell people for years, James. Thus, for the communists, claiming to own private property as an individual is theft. You have stolen that property from the commonwealth and the communal commonwealth to privatize it as yours. You are therefore subject to vicious anti-theft laws and the seizure of your property by the state. Does anyone want to guess if James is going to explain that colonization or colonialism also mean the claiming of indigenous land or communal land to be private property under the oppressive settler colonists? And this is the issue playing out in the Middle East between Israel and Gaza right now? I'm going to bet not, but let's just see. The state is empowered to seize all private property and redistribute it because it is the political embodiment of the people and is solely empowered with the capacity to distribute or redistribute property according to their description of just deserts of society's commonwealth, which they call equity today. Well, that's not exactly what they call equity, James, but, you know, I mean, James is moving closer. It's closer. James has not explained that when the state seizes all private property and redistributes it, that is a form of decolonization. The reason that James is not going to explain that that's what decolonization is James had a massive hissy fit several months ago after October 7th, in which he told everyone decolonization means violent revolution, when in fact decolonization does not mean violent revolution. Decolonization means removing the oppressive force of capitalism from the land or from the concept. It can be applied to other things as well. We're not going to get into that right now, but it can be. But decolonization just means removing capitalism, which means removing the private ownership of property, which is what James just described, which I guess in a roundabout way is equity, because you can't get equity as long as you have private property ownership. But he's so close. We're going to have to harangue James's ass on decolonization a little bit more, I see, so he starts to get more accurate in his descriptions. In Western Marxism, identity-based cultural and critical Marxism, this concept of property belonging to the communal commonwealth extends to the idea of cultural appropriation. Not exactly, James, but okay. Only the justified members of the collectivist community are entitled to use and benefit from the articles of cultural property generated by that community. This paragraph is completely wrong, according to what the left is teaching, so I would just disregard everything in that paragraph. This is an example of James reading a paper somewhere and deciding that that paper applies in the real world, when in fact the paper doesn't apply in the real world. But this is not what socialists say in real life, so we'll just move on. Black culture and its artifacts are Black community products produced by Black people for Black people. Black, in this case, should mean socialist. James isn't explaining that, though. Socialists believe that all Black people, because they are oppressed due to systemic racism, which was caused by capitalism, which is private property ownership, socialists believe that all Black people should rightfully be socialists. And so that's why he's putting that in quotes. I'm going to bet James doesn't explain why he's putting that in quotes, but that's what that means. Membership in this community requires some fealty or deference to the prevailing Marxist ideology. See, that's saying Black people should all be socialists. That defines the community through its lived experience, which is to say critical race theory. So close, James, so close. Rejecting CRT or its grifters, even if Black, could render you outside the collective and its protections. Well, James is right about that, but maybe another more succinct way to say that would be that the left loves white people who agree with the ideology. The left hates Black people who disagree with the ideology. And that is why whiteness means capitalism. Whiteness is not a reference to skin color. Whiteness is a reference to the system that upholds systemic racism. That is what the systemic and systemic racism means. The system that upholds racism. And that system is capitalism. If you are a Black person and you are a private business owner, you are considered to be the enemy because you are engaging in capitalism, which is what they do not like. And they believe that every Black person should be instead in solidarity with the proletariat, the oppressed workers, and they should be fighting back against the evil capitalist. If someone outside of a special communal community were to make use of the cultural capital of such a commonwealth, that would be regarded as cultural theft, as producers are no longer its sole beneficiaries, and the use of cultural property is therefore a cultural appropriation and the expropriates that commonwealth outside of the communal commonwealth is theft. You will notice it's treated as such. Well, that was a whole lot of word salad that doesn't actually mean anything practical, so let's move on. Land acknowledgements also falls under this form of logic, though not quite so precisely. You are on stolen land that used to belong to whatever tribes, blah, blah, blah. Those tribes had a completely different understanding of the ownership of land than we have in the West under the ideas of private property ownership and stewardship. The logic is the same then as it was used as a hybrid understanding of ownership. Well, we know this. We know this because we have watched the webinars out of Arizona State University. We also watched that Red podcast about love and communism, that they were talking about this, which is that they view indigenous people as the stewards of the property. The property is not theirs. They don't personally own the property, but it was entrusted to them to take care of. That's what they're talking about there. Yes, when communists say proletariat, they mean the worker. Under the forthcoming critical immigration theory, oh, I'm so glad James is talking about critical immigration theory, because James already has critical immigration theory wrong, because James asserted in a podcast we watched on this channel not too long ago that critical immigration theory would not include Ukraine. He said that the left wasn't going to support Ukraine, which is just, I mean, so easy to prove wrong. It's just ridiculous. The left overwhelmingly supports Ukraine. When I've been at socialist events, there are multiple tables of people supporting Ukraine. But James didn't think they were going to support Ukraine under critical immigration theory because Ukraine was white. And therefore, the left wouldn't support them because James still hasn't fully wrapped his head around the idea that whiteness has nothing to do with skin color. Anyway. Under the forthcoming critical immigration theory, now in development in the early stages of employment, migrant squatters have a human right to property in the sense of the global commonwealth. So your house located where they have been relocated in the ongoing invasion might become a part of the commonwealth. This is how they're being instructed, at least as they approach and enter the U.S. All of those houses will be yours, as so the reporting goes. Now, anyone that's been following my content for any length of time know that I literally say every day of my life that capitalism means private property ownership. Private property includes your ability to own a home, your ability to own land, your ability to own a rental unit as a landlord, a business, intellectual property, parental rights, individual liberties, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Why does it come as any surprise to James that the left wants to abolish your ability to own a home? Why is that new information? The left openly talks about this. The left talks about the fact that it is the government's responsibility to provide housing to everyone. If it is the government's responsibility to provide free housing to everyone, that means no one needs to privately own a home because the left does not believe in private property ownership. So this has nothing to do with any sort of critical immigration theory thing that James is making up. This is a core foundational belief of the socialist left. This is fundamental, and James fucking knows this. And this is why I harangue his ass so much, because he has read more than enough leftist content to understand that private home ownership is one of the primary things that the left wants to get rid of. For you to claim that your house and home are in fact your property is for you to be stealing from this broader, ill-defined commonwealth that you are automatically a part of, given by virtue of being a global citizen, whether you realize it or not. You are all stealing from the communal commonwealth of the globe by withholding your property from squatters. Well, it's not just that, James. It's not just about squatters, James. Squatters will be the excuse. Squatters will be the mechanism by which they go about abolishing private home ownership as much as they can. This is why, by the way, it's also impossible to like evict people if you're like a landlord. Why tenants have more rights than you do as a landlord. Why squatters have more rights than you do as a homeowner. All of this was put in place decades ago through laws and policies that the left got in place by getting into positions of power where they could get those laws on the books. Why are we talking about this now like it's a surprise? I've been screaming about this for over a year and a half. This is the communist logic behind that phenomenon. This is how they think. Of course they are completely wrong. Communal ownership is a socioeconomic catastrophe that fails in every scalable setting it has tried. Equal protection of the individuals under the law for their private property ensures greater fairness and justice than any other system humans have devised. Communism steals in the name of ending theft, and it does so, like always, by deliberately misunderstanding the relevant words through the lens of Marxist theory, which is not just false, but also diabolical and evil. While I think that James's last sentence here is particularly apt, by deliberately misunderstanding the relevant words through the lens of Marxist theory, did anyone catch what word James Lindsay did not say in that entire 12 paragraph post? James wrote 12 fucking paragraphs about the abolition of private property ownership. And he did not say the most important word that he could say. What word is missing from this entire post that my community knows? Because we're the only ones on the internet that actually watch this stuff. Is it capitalism? James isn't telling people this is capitalism. Why isn't James telling people that private property ownership means capitalism? Why does James refuse to use the word capitalism. It's very stark to people who understand the left, James. It's very stark to people like us. We spend 6 days a week, dozens of hours a week, watching leftist content. We know they say capitalism all the time, James. Why aren't you saying capitalism? Why does my audience know what the magic word is, James? You were so close, James. You were so... Maybe if you hadn't blocked Reagan and then told your entire audience to block Reagan, when Reagan is a better teacher of this stuff on Twitter than you are, James. Didn't say capitalism. When can we get James to say capitalism? We're obviously just going to have to harangue James's ass more. Everyone needs to create at least 3 new sock accounts in order to harangue James's ass to say capitalism. Kyle is correct. This is almost, it's almost like James is deliberately misunderstanding what the left means when they say capitalism, which is specifically defined as private property ownership. Isn't it funny that James has an entire fucking post about private property, doesn't say capitalism once, but my audience knows to say capitalism. Look how many people know the word capitalism, James. Well, he tries to be, doesn't he? He tries. Oh, well. My audience, smarter than James Lindsay's audience again. It's okay, James. It's okay. It's all right. You'll get there someday, James. I will struggle session your ass on the internet every fucking day if I have to until you start saying the word capitalism. And if you still refuse, we're just going to get more and more people on our team, James. We're going to make more and more memes. We're going to continue to call out your bullshit over and over and over and over and over until you get over whatever that fucking head injury did to your brain and actually get with the program and start teaching your audience that this is all about capitalism, which is specifically defined as private property ownership. Moving on, if you want to keep up on the latest news on the left and get information that you can't get anywhere else because I am the only one teaching it, make sure you head over to my Substack, which is Karlyn, karlyn.substack.com. On the Substack today, we have that crazy clip that we watched yesterday where Rutgers University has a lecture series that was funded to the tune of $225,000, in which they flew in a lecturer from the University of Illinois Chicago who did a whole tryst on how Israelis are raping Palestinian women and making Palestinian men watch in order to further punish them in anti-Arab violence. Now, I'm not commenting on the truth. I don't know if that's true or not. I truly don't know. I don't know either way. I'm sure Israel would never do that. The Israelis are a kind and peaceful people. They would never do that. But it does seem a little odd to me that that's being funded to the tune of $225,000. You can find that clip on my Substack now. While you're there, also make sure you sign up for my new 2-part series that's going to be starting on April 18th. This is going to be the How to Speak Socialist, Level 1 and 2. We're redoing Level 1. If you've already taken Level 1 with me before, you don't have to take it again. But Level 2 is going to be completely new. Going to be a deep dive into queer Marxism. This is going to be basically your crash course in the language of the left. I will teach you all the things that James Lindsay refuses to teach you, that everyone else refuses to teach you, and you will never have to take my word for it. I will never do pinky swear. Trust me, bro. All you need to do is watch the videos, because all I do is I show you videos of real life leftist trainings, and I break down what the language means, and I let you see it for yourself. You get to decide what you think about it. Both of these events are completely for free, but you can support the work I'm doing by making an optional donation if you want to, which I really do appreciate. Please sign up over on the Substack, and we'll look forward to that. And another way you can support the work I'm doing is by heading over to the Unwoke Art store, which is unwokeart.com. There are going to be some new designs coming next week to include those sticker books that I keep promising you guys. We right now have the April edition of the Unwoke Wiki t-shirt, which honestly might be one of my favorite ones yet. This is our plague doctor theme. And I wanted to get, it's almost spring, so I wanted to get some flowers in the design while still making it just look like rustic and badass. I'm pretty excited about that. That's the front of the shirt. Then we've got the back saying the socialist revolution is real, directing people to the Unwoke Wiki, which is a project that we are doing to catalog this shit, get it all in one place, make a mechanism where you can search for individual activists and organizations and stuff like that. And one of the ways we're going to fund that is by selling merch through the Unwoke Art Store. So you can get that limited edition t-shirt right now. You can also get it on hoodies, stickers, all sorts of other cool stuff. And all that goes to fund the work I'm doing. And I really do appreciate it. My birthday, actually, this is a perfect timing, Milo. My birthday isn't until next week, okay? So this is not my birthday. My birthday is next Friday, April 12th. And actually, I'm going to be doing something very special for my birthday. We're going to forego happy hour. And I'm going to be doing an all-day stream that's basically me reacting to influencers. Yes, I will be 29 again, obviously. I'm on it, Rottweiler. Relax. I'm on it. Relax. I will be 29 for my birthday, obviously. But you guys can join me all day next week. And if you have things that you want me to watch, let me know. And things that allow me to be uppity and bitchy. It's going to be kind of like, it's my day of narcissism, okay? It's my birthday. I can do what I want. That's what we're going to be doing next Friday. Let me get these other super chats. Rottweiler, thank you for being a member of the channel. In other conservative retardia news, Tim Pool is getting roasted by other influencers for his comments on DEI, despite starting to rebrand as Bridge. Oh, fun. What does Bridge mean? Belonging, something, something, diversity, gender, equity. I haven't heard this Bridge thing yet. Let me know what that means, Rottweiler. I'll look forward to that. Naruto says, I shared your autistic sex education spy stream on Twitter after Aria Scousella tweeted out a video asking about why autistic people think they're trans. Yeah, it's almost like I've been covering autistic sex education for over a year and a couple days, something like that. It's almost like influencers on the internet are always and perpetually behind where I am. Anyway, who's ready for some beer? We got to do beer first, and then we'll get into our presentation. I know that was a little bit long of an introduction, but Kristen says, my mom and nephew, Nibbling, have April birthdays also. April birthdays rule, except if you're a Taurus. Only Aries count in April. Only Aries. So, let's get to the beer. All right. Per our happy hour tradition, I have 4 craft beers here. I'm going to explain to you what the beers are. Then we're going to put a poll in the chat, and then you get to vote on which beer I drink. This poll is only available on YouTube, so sorry, Rumble and Twitter, for that. Our first one is from Rockingham Brewing Company. This is out of New Hampshire, I believe. This is a nice little pastry beer. It's called Strawberry Angel Food Cake Cream Ale. So this should be nice and light. Let's see. Apparently, it's an award-winning beer of some sort. So that's going to be our first one. Strawberry Angel Food Cake Beer. Tayton, you like the 45-minute intros? That was just a James Lindsay special. James Lindsay special. Oh no, don't be offended. You can't be offended. You're a fucking Taurus. You got to be even-keeled. Just like, relax. Relax, Taurus. Relax. Our next one is from Drecker Brewing. I think they're out of Massachusetts, which we won't judge them for that. No, North Dakota. Drecker Brewing does, they do these great kind of like smoothie beers that are kind of like dessert beers. And look at that can. Isn't that fun? You guys know I love a good beer can. This is called Schmoll. It is a little fruited sour that is a strawberry lemonade fruited sour. Let's see. Yeah, strawberry, lemon, and lemonade all in one beer. That's our second option. Then we're getting into our stouts. We've got Rational Gaze. I've never had this brewery before. But the reason I decided to try it is that it's a collaboration with a brewing company called Autodidact. And I was like, I'm an autodidact. So I had to get it. And this is called Rational Gaze. This is an imperial stout with maple syrup, coffee, and vanilla. And it is 10.5%. And then our last one, and I might be most excited about this one because it comes from one of my favorite breweries, which is Magnify Brewing Company, which is out in New Jersey. We'll have to forgive them for that. And this is called Peanut Butter Mind Over Matter, a double chocolate milk stout. So we've got a peanut butter and double chocolate stout. I mean, come on. Come on. And this is an imperial as well. This is 8%. All right, so these are our options. Let me put the poll in the chat. Again, we've got strawberry angel food cake. We have strawberry lemonade smoothie beer. We have maple coffee and vanilla. And we have peanut butter chocolate, baby. Let me know which one you want me to drink. In the meantime, let me get the sound set up for our federally funded gender training. I know you guys are all looking forward to this. Happy Friday. There we go. And as always, please do make sure you mount the like button for me, guys. Make sure you are subscribed on whatever platform you're watching on. Let me get my little cooler because I think I know which one you guys are going to vote for. Got to put the rest away for safekeeping. Where do I buy my beer? So New Hampshire has more craft breweries than like any other state per capita. And so because we have so many craft breweries, we also have a lot of craft beer stores. But craft beer stores are becoming more popular everywhere. And in a lot of places, you can get craft beer at the supermarket. Like I was just in Idaho. And I went in the supermarket. They had craft beer in the supermarket there. So you can actually start to get craft beer in the supermarket. You're not going to get as big a selection as you're going to get by going to a craft beer store. But I literally have two craft beer stores within like a 10-minute driving distance of my house. And I went to the further one away to get these because they have different selection. But just look up a craft beer store in your area and you can try some beer too. Rottweiler just posted the bridge acronym in chat. Okay, hang on. I missed it. Let me go back. Thank you, Rottweiler. Bridge means benchmarking race, inclusion, and diversity in global engagement. Okay. Duh. They changed the language. I know we're all shocked by that. All right, peanut butter stout wins. So we'll have us a peanut butter stout. Let's get this party started, guys. We're already 45 minutes in. We are watching a federally funded gender training, identity affirmation, and its impact, non-binary and transgender identities.
Hi, everyone.
Welcome, everyone. My name is Suki Steckel, and I'm with INTAC, and I will be your moderator for this session. And I'm very pleased to welcome Skylar Blankenship, who is going to present to you identity affirmation and its impact, non-binary and transgender identities. Please help me in welcoming Skylar. And please do remember to put your questions about the content of their session in the Q&A bubbles on the vertical menu, and please join us in staying engaged via the chat. And I'll be here to support all of you along the way. Take it away, Skylar.
Hi, I'm Skylar. I'm gonna have everybody go ahead and put it in the chat, the name that they want to use, their pronouns, and just because we're from everywhere, what state you're from.
Skylar is a they, them, I'm gonna bet.
Awesome. And I'll keep talking as this goes, just so that we can be more
a
familiar
federally
with each other.
Funded
I feel
they,
like
them.
Having at least a mutual respect of names and pronouns is really important. So obviously, as you can tell by the beginning of the slide, I'm here to present on identity.
I am sure that is not a woman with a beard. That is absolutely not a woman with a beard. Skylar is either going to be a they, them, or a he, him, or a he, they, or a they, he. That is definitely not a woman with a beard.
Affirmation and its impact on non-binary and transgender youth. So there's going to be a lot of content, and we got a little less time than we had anticipated, so I might be a little bit quicker to go through information, but I promise there is space for everybody to speak, and we will get there. Okay, here we go. So before we get started, a little bit about me is my educational background is that I received my bachelor's from Central Michigan University in psychology, child development, and communication disorders. And then I went on to get my master's degree in clinical mental health, both at Central Michigan University. Some experience that I have with this is that I started public speaking during my undergraduate degree just about 10 years ago, if that dates me at all. And I've covered topics including like sexual health, mental health, suicidality, transgender and non-binary identities, sexual assault and intimate partner, and domestic violence. And within those, many of those topics, I talked about specifically like LGBTQ populations and have a bit more of a focus on trans populations. So just kind of kicking it off again, my name is Skylar and my pronouns are they, them, and an AA in Spanish.
See?
I identify as non-binary trans masculine.
See, they, them, everyone owes me $2.
And I have been working within the community for several years. Local to here in Grand Rapids, last year, I was part of the Trans Icons in the Making, which is a scholarship program for trans individuals to help like with higher education that are trying to work to better the community. So I was really lucky to receive that, and it's been a really great experience. So I really hold that special to me, and I continue to carry it into really charging my advocacy, not only as a person in the community, but also as a therapist. I work in a community-based agency where I'm an outpatient therapist for youth and families. So we'll start with some ground rules, just because there is some discussion base in this. My first thing is always share the floor. We all have incredibly important things to say and bring.
This person is not transitioning from being a man to a woman. Other way. Dayton, thank you for the super chat. Sorry, I just bit down on a cough drop. Because my throat is feeling scratchy. In the psychology profession, is it not good when someone specifically is in a form of bias for the greater good of their ideology? I don't understand what you're... Tayton, I think you missed a word or two. I don't understand what you're saying. In the psychology profession, is it not good when someone specifically is in a form of bias for the greater good of their... I mean, I'm not exactly sure what you're asking, Tayton. I do apologize. If you want to clarify, let me know.
Bring things to the table and all kinds of perspectives. So,
well, it was strawberry.
Able to share the floor, like sharing the mic. We all have things to say, so making sure we're sharing that. And then take what you need and leave the rest here. So taking lessons, taking information with you, but also making sure to leave stories and personal information here in this room, because we want to respect
All right, Dog Whistle Daniel's new. So this is our opportunity to help Dog Whistle Daniel. He says, non-binary almost seems like a symptom for communist, although I'm sure some people who aren't communists identify as non-binary. Guys, how would you respond to what Dog Whistle Daniel wrote? And this is for people who've been around for a while. How are we responding to Dog Whistle Daniel? This is a good opportunity to teach other people, because there are probably a lot of people, Daniel, who have that same perception as you do. So I'm not trying to pick on you or anything. Let me know how you would respond to him. Tayton says, I feel like a lot of these people get into psychology and therapy positions to further the bias within their ideology. Well, a lot of people get into psychology because they're hurt people. And they want to know how to fix themselves. And so they think that by learning how to fix themselves, they'll learn how to fix other people. So I wouldn't say it's specifically to further their bias. It's more like I'm effed up. And so I don't want other people to be as effed up as I am. Let's see. Non-binary means that you want to abolish the gender binary, which the left believes was created by capitalism to feed the system. Non-binary is going against the gender binary because they want to abolish the gender binary. Communists want to abolish the gender binary because they believe it was created by capitalism. Okay, you guys are getting closer, but you guys aren't answering Daniel's actual question, though. Non-binary is queer. Queer is a far-left Marxist ideology. Abolish gender, and queer means to transcend and transform. Okay, guys. I need everyone to pay attention. I know that I drill you on the concepts and I say the same basic thing over and over and over and over and over again. But when someone asks a question like this, then is not the talking point. Don't do me. Don't just repeat me. What you need to do, and I'm trying to teach you how to teach other people right now, if someone says something like this, you need to specifically adjust your answer to what they're saying. Because what I'm seeing people do in the chat, when I'm asking you to answer Daniel's question, is I'm seeing you repeat my talking points, which is fine. I'm glad you know my talking points. But what I need you to be doing is adjusting those to explain directly to Daniel based on what he's asking. All right. So what he's asking is, non-binary almost seems like a symptom for communist, although I'm not sure people who aren't communists identify as non-binary. I need you guys to speak directly to this. Do not repeat my talking points verbatim. You're not going to get credit for that. Peyton says, thank you. I appreciate that, Peyton. Non-binary is a political stance and form of activism against the gender binary. Okay, you guys still aren't, like, come on. Gayla, thank you. Non-binary is communist. Non-binary, queer, is a far-left political ideology. That's what they're putting forward when they're identifying as non-binary or queer. They're saying they're a communist. They're saying they're a Marxist, a socialist. No, it is not this. No, wrong answer, Tinge. It is not accurate to say that there are non-binary people who are not communists. I'm sorry. That is just not accurate. That is not accurate. Like, pretty much everyone who identifies as non-binary has been indoctrinated into a far-left political ideology. This is not helpful. I'm kind of getting disappointed in the chat already, and we're only 4 minutes into this presentation. This is not helpful. It is not helpful to say some kids identify as non-binary without knowing where it's coming from. No. Those kids, although they are being indoctrinated into a cult, they are not useful idiots if they are identifying as non-binary, guys. All queers are Marxists, but not all Marxists are queer. Good. I like that. See, now I'm having to read what people say. Nope. Wrong answer, everyday therapist. That's not correct, although it's closer than some. Okay, no correct answers in the chat. The closest correct answer was Milo. I believe it was Milo. Hang on. Closest correct answer was this. I'm disappointed, guys. Please do better next time. Thank you.
Confidentiality, as well as speak for yourself. It's really easy to kind of take an overarch in our dialogue, but also making sure that we're speaking from our own.
The reason that I'm disappointed... Well, you're still wrong, Tinge. Like, you can disagree all you want, but that is wrong. That is incorrect. It is provably wrong. It's going to be one of those days, I see. The reason that I am disappointed is because the whole purpose of me spending all my time doing this is to teach you guys how to teach other people. That was a softball question for most of you. For the people, and I'm not talking to the people who are new. If you're new, that's fine. Everyone is a beginner at some point. I'm not talking to you. I'm talking to the people who have been here for years. That was a softball question. Non-binary almost seems like a symptom for communist, although I'm sure some people who aren't communists identify as non-binary. The answer to that is everything related to non-binary is communist. You cannot be non-binary and not have a foot in the far left political ideology. It is not possible. The whole point of being non-binary is to identify as no binary, with the goal of queer Marxism being to abolish the gender binary. So no, there is no reality in which anyone is identifying as non-binary and they do not have a foot in a far left political ideology. And whether they realize the extent of it or not, it does not matter. Every single person identifying as non-binary is buying into that ideology. They may come to realize it, they may not come to realize it, but it doesn't matter whether they are consciously aware of it or not. Does everyone understand? I'm going to pause and I'm going to give you guys an opportunity to ask questions because no one got the answer right. Exactly. Non-binary always means communist or people being indoctrinated by communists. Always. That's not to say that all Marxists or communists buy into queer Marxism. This is why Milo had the only correct answer. All queers are Marxist, not all Marxists are queer. Does everyone understand?
Own experiences just because everybody's is different. And then lastly, please respect pronouns, names, and identity. We're not here to police, we're not here to use the wrong names or pronouns, and just making sure that we're really keeping a respectful space. And at any point, if I am talking too fast, please let me know. I am a fast talker. So if you're like, Skylar, I need you to slow down, please say so.
Well, Rick, no. I do not expect that people are going to be just parroting my talking points verbatim, which is why we do so much of this. People give different answers literally all the time, literally every day. What I need people to do is to be able to adapt the correct answer to the question. And so if you're just parroting my talking points without thinking about what's being asked, that is not what I am looking for. And if someone wants to blame the fact that I named my show The Cult as a joke for an excuse about why they can't adapt talking points to a specific question being asked, I'm going to say that's not fucking good enough and I expect better. There is a reason that my audience is years ahead of everyone else on the internet talking about this stuff. There is a reason that my audience can run fucking circles around James Lindsay. That's because they know more than other people. I do not have low expectations for my audience. We are not fucking mindless drones. We are not NPCs. We are not your average conservative morons who are just repeating the same old thing over and over and over and over and over again. That's not what we do here. If that's the expectation, people have misunderstood.
Okay, so I believe you're able to turn your mics on. I have never used AirMeet before, so this is an adventure for all of us. I just kind of want to, before we dive into it, see what folks have experience with trans and non-binary youth Do you work with them? Do you have family members or children? Do you work within the community? I think you can just turn on your mics. Or maybe not. Maybe I am incorrect. Okay, there we go. I can see it in the chat now. It took a second.
Maybe no one wants to.
Okay, great. And I just encourage those to keep coming in. It's really great to see different experiences from everybody and just really see how we interact in the community or the services we have.
No, Naruto, this is not right. Similar to all Antifa are Marxist, but not all well, no, actually that is actually right. Never mind. I spoke too soon. So Naruto is saying it's similar to how all Antifa are Marxist, but not all Marxists are Antifa. Yeah, that's actually a really good analogy for queer. Antifa's like a bunch of like, it's like the infantry is what Antifa is. It's like the foot soldiers. It's something for like the younger people to like rally around. You're not going to see like a lot of older Antifa and stuff like that. So yeah, good analogy. I appreciate that. Does care in this context mean support equity? I mean, care always means support equity because part of the reason they want equity in the first place is about communal care. Having access to like all healthcare resources, to include mental health resources, to include trans affirming care, to include abortion up until including birth, all that stuff. So like the major push behind abolish the family is all about care, not only for children, but also for the elderly, in which they say that in the nuclear family, you are limited to the resources that the nuclear family has in terms of providing mental health care, physical health care, stuff like that. And so if you eliminate the nuclear family, all of a sudden everyone's going to have access to the same resources for care. So yeah, care is one of their number one things always.
Right, or even just really the education that comes in. And then also just within that, also, as we answer that question, what are some ways that you could positively impact this community in your life? I see a lot of folks who have children or like are foster parents, which is great. As well as lots of folks that work in the community, which is also great because I love seeing that everybody's coming to expand their knowledge or come into a space where they can have dialogue. Awesome. And then for the sake of time, I'm just going to kind of skip forward, but please keep putting that in the chat. Okay. So I want to preface this by saying that while this isn't a complete list, it does give the understanding of the basic terms of identities within the population I'm going to talk about today. And so these are the identities under the umbrella, specifically just for the purpose of this presentation. So with a lot of the studies and research that I've had under the transgender umbrella, it was very like basic down to transgender man, transgender woman, and some non-binary folks also identify as transgender. Whereas a lot of the research indicating for non-binary identities was trans masculine folks, trans femme folks, and agender, bigender, new choice, gender non-conforming, and a lot of other terms.
New choice? What is new choice?
So
new
from
choice?
Some of the research, it kind of identified that trans masculine folks that are non-binary leaned towards more masculine traits or identity, whereas the opposite side, trans femme, went more towards that more feminine identity and identification. We'll kind of go into the next part.
I wanted to know what new choice is. Can someone just Google that real quick? New choice. It's like three. Toi. New toi. Is that like French or something? I mean, I know that much French. Can someone just Google that? Thank you, bot. Appreciate it. New toi is a non-binary identity in which a person sees themselves as neither a man nor a woman and has no gender to express. So it's like agender. Okay. Thank you. Thank you, guys. I appreciate it.
Which is some mental health diagnoses. And while this is not comprehensive in the least bit, and there is way more research left to be done, for the sake of the research that I'm using in this presentation, the three basics that were covered were depression, anxiety, and suicidality. So for the purpose of this presentation, depression is the chronic experience of hopelessness, sadness, and despair. So those tend to be the most clinical beginning symptoms of depression. So that was a lot of what was focused on in the research, as well as anxiety being episodic or chronic experiences of elevated fight or flight response, worrying thoughts, and uncontrollable panic. Again, these are our basic markers, and so that's really what the research that I had looked into has followed. As well as, for the purpose of this presentation, suicidality was classified as thoughts, urges, or intent to end one's life, and this can include passive thoughts, thoughts of intent, plans, and action. So let's look at some statistics and really just see kind of how this impacts the community. So a research article by Ashley Austin in 2020 found that the internet is providing trans and gender diverse youth affirming spaces that for the most part don't exist in their online lives. And then within that, these experiences are fostering well-being, healing, and growth. And they found in through five processes. One was building an escape from stigma and violence, as well as experiencing belonging, building confidence, feeling hope, and giving back. These online experiences are giving them a space where they can go to seek out their own community, as well as exist in a space where they can come as they are. And while that's not 100% everywhere and all inclusive of the internet, it is something that has been found to be an experience. As well as being able to find these communities online, they have a sense of belonging, right? You are intentionally entering a space where you are accepted.
Hey, Mark, I wanted to let you know, I'm going to send out your Substack to my entire Substack audience. I'm sorry I've been non-responsive on that. I'm glad you stopped by, though. I didn't want you to think I was ignoring you. I've just been super, super busy, bro. But, I'm definitely going to, you know, guys, everyone, Mark has started a Substack. I definitely want to encourage everyone to follow Mark, support what Mark's doing. I'm going to be sending out a note to my Substack. So I just wanted you to know, I didn't forget. I was just really busy. So I'm glad you made it.
You have common interest experience. And within that, being affirmed in those spaces is building that confidence, right? The longer we're affirmed in our identity, the more sure and the more strength we have in it. And then feeling hope, having those affirmations, building that confidence and having a space that's safe and welcoming really gives hope that, well, life is worth living. It's worth existing in. And then giving back. The online community is a great way to give back to other trans and non-binary individuals, both as adolescents and adults. It's where we can give advice. It's where we can really share our knowledge, share our research, share other community events, even outside of the internet, that we can go and belong. For the most part, though, there are a lot of really great online support groups and really great communities that are fostered online. Due to COVID, a lot of our support groups moved to a more online format. While there's cost and benefits to that, there's a lot more access now to have that belonging, at least in a face-to-face format, where through most of it used to be chat logs. I see Discord. So Discord. Trans and gender diverse.
Wait. Is this real? Did he really do that? Oh shit, I'm streaming that. When is that? Hang on. Tayton, if you're lying to me, I'm going to be very upset. Yo! Yo! It's real! It's real. Holy shit. Look at this. Candace tweeted, I would like to debate Ben Shapiro on Israel and the current definition of anti-Semitism. And Ben tweeted, sure, Candace, I texted you on February 29th offering this very thing. He is such a little bitch. Let's do it on my show this Monday at 5 p.m. in our studios. 90-minute live streamed. Yeah! Awesome! Awesome! Excellent. I will be streaming that on Monday. You guys can all come and join me if you want. It's going to be great. I'm sure she's not paying the Daily Wire, though, so hopefully that's all free.
Youth are experiencing some pervasive stigma, discrimination, and violence in homes, schools, and communities, right? We've heard stories of kids in rural towns experiencing such heavy stigma and unfortunately at higher rates of death and suicidality.
Wait, is that the eclipse
and that's
day?
Not exclusive to rural communities. We see that in funny. Well, metropolitan cities, suburbs. It's really relates.
Yeah, are we having, is that the solar eclipse day? Oh shit. Joshua tried to tell me about the eclipse, but I was thinking about other things in my head and I'm not sure I paid close attention to it. That's going to be explosive.
It's back to the place that you live, but then you add on also schools. Schools add another entire layer to this because with adolescents, there's a power dynamic. Right? We have teachers, principals, and other adults that already have a higher power dynamic because they're adults. So not only do we have peers of the same age enforcing this stigma, discrimination, and violence, we also have adults that not only are reinforcing that in their peers, but also sometimes also contributing to that, which not only is that just not okay because you're utilizing that power dynamic, but it's also reinforcing the idea that who this child is, who these youth are, is not valid, it's not okay, and it's not safe. So social supports, a sense of belonging and the ability to live authentically, which is to live and be treated in a manner consistent with the gender identity rather than the gender assigned at birth, are key sources of that resilience among these individuals. Excuse me. So creating these systems are really important. And what we're seeing is that offline, these experiences aren't as common, especially in smaller areas or areas who have a higher rate of poverty and have a really lack of sense of education due to so many different socioeconomic barriers. And then another study that was done by Durwood found that self-worth is an important predictor of future mental health outcomes. I mean, I feel as if that could be self-explanatory.
That's
right?
True for
even
everyone.
Taking it out of trans and non-binary populations. Really, our sense of self-worth can be a really big predictor of our future success or future resiliency. And really, a lot of that ties into our mental health outcomes. By identifying these students as they are and affirming their identities, listening to these voices come to us and say, this is who I am, and this is what I need to continue to be who I am. By continuing to just honor that and affirm that and give them a voice, we're helping predict future mental health outcomes. The longer we see depression sit in youth, and a lot of times identity that is not affirmed takes away that sense of belonging, which feeds into that depression. And the long-term depression becomes, well, worse depression and can lead to other mental health outcomes as well. And then the study found that youth that were able to socially transition had similar depression and anxiety rates as cisgender youth. Did mice? Sorry about that. I think my slides just disappeared.
They're back. Oh no. Socialist technology always fails. every time.
Are my slides still up for everybody?
Yes.
Okay, perfect. They disappeared for me, so I wasn't sure if they disappeared for everybody else.
Literal neckbeard. Yes.
Awesome. So the study found that youth that were able to socially transition had similar depression and anxiety rates as cisgender youth. So even just that ability to socially transition, which takes away physical transition, including hormones, surgery, any different types of identity affirmation, like care in terms of medical. This is just socially. So that can include dressing in a way that affirms their identity. This can include utilizing their name in social situations and within groups. That is their name and utilizing their pronouns. They had similar depression and anxiety rates as cisgender youth.
Thank you for asking, Mark. I'm drinking an Imperial Peanut Butter Double Chocolate Stout.
So
if anyone else is drinking something fun, please feel free to put what you're drinking in the chat to inspire all of us.
I know the statistics are relatively high still for depression, anxiety, and cisgender youth, and just really youth in general, due to like brain functionality, just existing factors. So seeing that is similar is a big deal. It's that social transition component, that simple identity.
Hang on. Thank you for the super chat, Freedom. Freedom says, I look forward to attending your crash course on how to speak the socialist language of the left on April 18th. I appreciate that. Guys, if you have not yet signed up for my crash course, you can head over to Karlyn, karlyn.substack.com. It is right on the homepage right now. It is completely free to sign up. If you have friends that need to know this, if you have family that needs to know this, feel free to send it to them. If you can't make it to the live show on April 18th, then what you can do is sign up anyway. And what's going to happen is you're going to get sent a video recording of the session after I do it. Okay, so everyone who signs up will get access to the video. The video will be on demand later as well. But definitely come sign up, come join us if you need that crash course. And if you've already taken my level one course, you probably don't need to take this one again, but you can still sign up for the level two, which is going to be a deeper dive into queer Marxism. You're drinking a German smoked beer? That sounds pretty good, Ketson. A vanilla bean cappuccino? That sounds good.
The affirmation is really raising or lowering that depression and anxiety rate in that community, as well as they had similar rates of self-worth as their cisgender student counterparts. So like we said earlier, that rate of self-worth is what helps predict not only positive future mental health outcomes, but also increase that sense of belonging, which increases positive outcomes and really just a great affirmation. Okay.
I just put the link in the chat.
Some more research from Dr. Olson found that socially transitioned prepubescent transgender children show typical rates of depression and only slightly elevated rates of anxiety symptoms compared to the population averages. So normally there is a big gap in the rates of depression and anxiety in transgender and gender nonconforming youth versus cisgender populations. So, and there's a little bit more statistics later in that. But to see that those rates are very similar is astounding, to say that impact is so important, that socially transition was able to provide that identity for them, the affirmation to really be who they are, which increases their self-worth because, well, getting to be who we are increases our self-worth, right? It shows that we're worthy of being in this life, in this community, in this world as who we are, not maybe necessarily who tells us who we are. And then they concluded in the study that the findings suggest that familial support in general, or specifically via the decision to allow children to socially transition, are associated with better mental health outcomes among this population. So familial support is a huge thing, right? Just in general, we think about the support we have from our parents, our siblings, and really our whole family.
This is the part where this is the part where they, them is basically saying, if you don't affirm your child, they will literally die.
in how we interact with the world. They're our first support system, or lack of support system.
Oh, that sounds
good,
Mark.
So this is how we learn to interact in the world. This is how we learn what support is. And if we have that support not affirming who we are, or not accepting that identity, well, that sense of belonging is diminished. And then going in to school where their identity may also be diminished. And really,
well, I don't know that I would say it like that. I would say that they take advantage of every opportunity they have to advance their ideology. And this is a federally funded training. Why wouldn't they take advantage of this? This just pushes their ideology out to the masses.
Other places in the world, it's creating a gap in that support and that affirmation, and really leading to some of the negative core values. Is that like who I am doesn't matter, or who I am is wrong. That really feeds into that depressive and sometimes anxiety behavior. And parents really being supportive of the decision for their children to socially transition gives them a sense of belonging, really support, being able to have more support in that area, right? Children don't always have the most power, adolescents either, because, well, they're young and it's adults' responsibility to kind of help manage that world, whether that's for better or for worse in some situations.
It's not a bad idea, human centipede.
So really being able to have that power to explore that, be that, and really affirm that that is the life that they're going to live with powers that assist in the easier time is really important. And this also carries into hopefully having support systems to enable.
This is a great idea. We could do a beer trade. I can send you some beers from New Hampshire. You can send me some beers from Michigan. We should start a whole beer trade club. That's actually a really good idea. We should do that.
Mm-hmm. Well, that identity in school, having parents going to the school and assuring that.
Because if we can't drink, we are totally fucked.
Being affirmed and they are being who they are at school. And it, again, it really ties back to that sense of belonging, that sense of self-worth. And it really just gives a positive mental health outcome. And so there's some more from Dr. Olson. The articles that Dr. Olson has put out have been really great. So I referenced it a lot in doing some more of my research alongside what I've experienced being in the community and working with trans youth as well. So the observational evidence has shown that once children have socially transitioned, the intense gender dysphoria often settles down and shows improvement in behavior and mood. And while that's also not an exact science, that social transition so early in life helps reduce some of that intense gender dysphoria because, well, they're being affirmed, they're being socially accepted in who they are.
You know what we should do? You guys know that website. What is it? Like that website where you can match up people around Christmas to do like a secret Santa exchange. We should have everyone sign up that wants to do a beer exchange, and then you get randomly assigned a partner, and you have to send a partner like 2 craft beers from your state, and they have to send you 2 craft beers from their state or something like that. That would be so fun. That's a really good idea. We're definitely going to do that. Yo, American Horror Story, the earlier ones, season 2, like, might be my favorite of all the American Horror Stories.
And it gives a really big validity. And so that dysphoria, as it settles down, having a better behavior and mood, it's reducing rates of depression because, again, it ties back to the self-worth and the self-affirmation as well. Because being affirmed from our supports around gives us the ability to also internally affirm ourselves. It gives us the strength to know that who I am is okay. My identity is okay. Like I belong. I belong as I am. And so this also starts to reduce the inter-peer interactions where there's bullying and really just not okay behavior, like higher.
My actual favorite one of American Horror Story is The Hotel. I loved The Hotel season. Now I want to watch American Horror Story. God damn it.
Like aggression, higher really like verbal aggression on top of physical aggression, and just like that sense of diminished peer belonging. So seeing behaviors and mood improve with that, because they're not in a constant state of fight or flight, not knowing if they're safe at school or if they want to be there even, because they're going to face so many like obstacles. And then professionals should have no concern over supporting the family or mental health team's decision and reassuring the parents that social transition should have little to no negative impact on their child's mental health. So a big thing that was going around a few years ago and is also unfortunately resurfacing again is that allowing children to transition, it creates a sense of misunderstanding, confusion, and negative mental health outcomes, because you're allowing your child not to just be who they are. You're taking away that sense of, you're letting them play, dress up, and all of the awful rhetoric that goes around with that. And so a lot of professionals have been back off about it because of a lot of, unfortunately, the media and what it says. And there shouldn't be a concern of that negative mental health impact, because, well, a lot of the research shows that it's actually the opposite.
Wow.
That no. By allowing social transition, even in younger youth, actually increases positive mental health outcomes, especially in the future. And then just, we've talked kind of about the basic rates of like depression and anxiety within this context, but what about suicide and suicidality? Well, in a study that was created by Durwood 2016, and obviously it has been updated significantly, and there is another research coming out to have these rates measured, that some estimates have suggested that as many as 41% of transgender adults have attempted suicide in their lifetime. But what we remember is that trans adults come from trans children. And
I heard something about this. Sweden is crazy. Our conservative government in Sweden is on its way to allowing 16-year-olds to change their legal gender. This is done through institutional power because people don't know what non-binary means. And that's why it's so important, guys. This is why I know, like, people think that, like, I'm crazy for just repeating the same thing over and over and over and over and over again. But there are so many people in the world, not just in the United States, in the world, that don't know what non-binary means. Even though, like, for us, it might be so clear. Non-binary means no binary. That's what it means. It means the elimination of the gender binary. But most people have no idea what it means. And I think a lot of people, especially people who are tuned into what's going on with this stuff, we assume that because we know it, everyone else knows it. No. This is why we need to create an army of people who are teaching this stuff to other people, teaching it in plain English, teaching it in a way that normal people can understand. This is why we need the video clips, because video and getting people to see for themselves is like the very best evidence that you can provide them. This is why we need to stop making it a fucking tribalist partisan issue where the conservative right is building a narrative saying, we killed DEI, we're winning, we're winning. This is why it's so harmful, that we're winning analogy, because it's like, we're not winning. Most people don't know what's going on. The conservatives have really fucked up the possibility of mass pushback by telling their audience, we're winning, we're winning. Because there's nothing more the average conservative likes than to be complacent. There's nothing more they get off on than being complacent and saying, we're winning. I don't have to do anything. They took care of it. Someone else came and saved me again. They're shooting themselves in the foot. Maybe it's because they know they've already lost and they want to make as much money as possible. I don't know.
This study with adults was young adults. So we already know that at that age, particularly 17 to 24, one of the second leading causes of death.
I'm not a feminist. Why would you be mad? Why would I be mad?
And then suicide by Austin in 2020 is that suicide risk is particularly high with the transgender and gender diverse populations. Data indicated that 82% of trans individuals have considered and contemplated suicide, and 40% have attempted suicide. That is an astounding number. Even just the attempt rate is incredibly high. That's almost half. And this is inclusive of both adults and youth. And that's a really heavy population.
True.
And then the United States transgender survey found that among respondents who attempted suicide, more than one third, so 34%, reported that their first attempt was at the age of 13 or younger. 13 or younger, that's middle school and younger. And unfortunately, the study didn't say the relative younger age, like if this goes to 7 years old, 5 years old. So to truly have the impact of that statement without even just that young specifier is so powerful. And another indicator of why social transition is so incredibly important during these formative years. And 39% of respondents reported that their first attempt at court occurred between 14 and 17, which, you know, that's a suicidality rate of that age is also heightened. But even more so, the impact, those percentages are high.
Hang on. Jerry on Twitter says they're doing that because they're pushing them to be trans. No, they're not. No, they're not. Does anyone want to correct Jerry? What did Jerry get wrong in this sentence? I'm not trying to pick on you, Jerry. I'm really not. Like, there's no hard feelings, bro. This is not personal, but I want to make sure we're being accurate. And this is important. They are not pushing anyone to be trans. They're pushing them to be what? What are they pushing people to be? They want the kids to be queer to abolish the gender binary. Trans is not non-binary. Even when you're trans, there is a man and a woman. What they're pushing is for kids to be queer, which means non-binary. Non-binary is what they're trying to do. The goal of queer Marxism is not to establish a Gnostic sex cult. It is not to groom children for pedophiles. That is not what the goal is. The goal is always and forever to eliminate the gender binary by making everything non-binary. And it's an important distinction. It's one that people need to make. There is a difference between trans and queer. Trans, when it means transition from a man to a woman or a woman to a man, upholds the gender binary. They're still saying there are men and there are women. When you're talking about transcending the gender binary, transforming the gender binary, abolishing the gender binary, that is queer. Queer is a far left political ideology. Normal trans people are our allies in this. Mark Meets World is in the chat right now. Mark Meets World thinks there are men and women. Mark Meets World transitioned from being a woman to being a man. Buck Angel transitioned from being a woman to being a man. That upholds the gender binary. These people are our friends. These people are some of the greatest assets we have in terms of reaching people with this message. We always have to make sure we're not shitting on just normal trans people, guys. They don't deserve it. This is not the fight they got into. This is about stopping a far left political ideology. That is what it is. I'm going to be going on Buck's show. We need to work out a date, but I'm going to be going on his show. So we've already actually talked about it. I just don't have a date yet. And that's my fault. That's not Buck's fault. That's my fault because I've been busy.
high, and they're not far off from each other. But to think that anywhere from 17 to younger, the rates of over a third of these children are thinking about attempting and attempting suicide because of
rape. Pink Floyd says there are a lot of trans activists that want to change the definition of man and woman. No, there aren't. There are queer activists who want to change the definition of man and woman. Those are not trans activists. Those are queer activists. Those are two different things.
It's linked to depression and anxiety and living in constant states of, most have reported fear of not knowing even if they're safe. And so also being not affirmed, you're living in a space where you don't belong. It's a message constantly that who you are isn't who you are. You're wrong. It's wrong. Hearing that from everywhere and not having that affirmation, of course, that sense of belonging is diminished. And when we don't feel secure, our rates of depression heighten. And then as our depression continues to heighten, those thoughts, that prolonged sense of despair and unbelonging, really creates that helplessness, that hopelessness, and really just creates an environment where this is not feasible to live in a world where you can't be you. And then kind of what did all this mean? The statistics indicate that there's not enough affirmation happening outside of virtual settings.
Seriously?
And this can further down the line present other risks.
We just have to be more affirming, so, guys. That's all we need to do. Just be more affirming, really, okay?
We can't just live in an online world, right? COVID has made that a little more of a commonality and ability. But at the end of the day, especially as things begin to open up more during the pandemic, living in a completely virtual world just isn't feasible. And that leaving those virtual settings where they are being affirmed, where they are living in a space where they are okay to exist as who they are, they're hearing the messages that who they are belongs, who they are is real. And really having to step away from that and go out into another version of the world that is also applicable to their life. And hearing the messages that are almost contradictory to that, right? That being trans is wrong, being non-binary is wrong, being anything other than cisgender is wrong, and you're not those things, and so many other awful things. But not only does that parallel really stagger and astound somebody from hearing such strong messages on two different sides, we're also taking that one safe space to really bring it into a space that's not safe. And it presents other risks, right? We go back into a world with that lack of affirmation and that lack of rights, essentially. And you see other risks like verbal aggression, right? Being harassed, being yelled at, being preached at about how wrong you are and what you're doing is not right. You're also leaning into other risks like violence, right? We have not only violence in the classroom, like shoving, kicking, but we also see that there is significant deadly attacks. There's murder. There's such intense, like, assault that it...
No, Teresa, trans is fine. Queer is what the problem is. You guys always got to remember, sometimes you hear the term trans and they mean transition from a man to a woman or woman to man. That's fine. As long as they're upholding the gender binary, we don't really care. But queer wants to transcend or transform the gender binary. The key is, do they believe in a gender binary or not? Do they believe there are men and women and that's it? Or do they believe there are 8,000 genders and identify as a they, them? That's what we're talking about.
does eventually lead to either death by injuries or just a really negative impact. And we see those repeated instances of trauma going into other risks too, as well, with like substance use to deal with trauma, to reduce that fight or flight and to really find a way to cope. And also just substance use in general.
That sounds good.
So there's a lot of risks that come from this, as well as, you know, transgender, gender diverse and NB populations have higher rates of suicidality because of this lack of affirmation in their daily life, in their connections and systems. They're not getting that affirmation in a lot of places, a majority of this community. While I won't say 100%, a majority of this community does face a lot of lack of affirmation, right? We see it really anywhere, the news, in schools, in agencies. So doctors, mental health practitioners, really anybody, specialists, they see, we're seeing that there's a lack of affirmation and not really being able to create a system where trans and gender diverse individuals and youth can be. They're not going into a space and hearing their names, hearing their pronouns, acknowledging that who they are. And it's really despairing.
But NB is non-binary. NB. It's spelling out EN is the letter N, BYB, non-binary, NB.
It's hard to live in a world where you don't belong because everybody else is saying you don't belong, right? And so that despair really creates this hopelessness. And that's why we see higher rates of suicidality. And then those that are affirmed have similar rates to cisgender teens. So we saw that when teens are identified or are affirmed in their identity, they are showing similar rates of mental health outcomes as cisgender teens. Whereas in society, a typicality is that cisgender teens are really truly validated in who they are because that's what society deems as the appropriate, right? So they're being affirmed in their name, their identity, and their given expression. And so when we have these socially transitioning youth that are also being affirmed in the same way, we're seeing similar rates to mental health outcomes. I see a question. Looks like Millie said, how can we encourage our young person to move from the safe virtual world they have found when nearly all communication with peers is virtual as well? That is a really great question. And I would hope to have a more comprehensive, like, all-knowing answer, but it's still something that we're all still trying to figure out because this is definitely the age of technology, right? Kids are glued to their phones and a lot of this communication has become virtual. And that also is in part with COVID, but it's also in part with that's just the technology that's been changing in our communities. And I really think that we need to create more affirmative spaces. We need to create those safe spaces that exist outside of the virtual world, right? How can we expect these kids to move into these spaces outside of the virtual world when they have no other safe space? And typically the safe spaces that are virtual are creating those communication.
All right, so we got a question coming in on Rumble and I don't recognize the person it's coming in from. So we're gonna assume that they're new. Welcome. This is for I don't know how to say your name, bro, but AMCREBLSSTT says, I gotta ask, what is queer? Just listening and trying to wrap my head around it. I'm open. I have some questions. Guys, I want to remind everyone, especially if you're newer to my content and you haven't watched Socialism or The Far Left. Okay, we're going to go with AMC. I appreciate that. Please ask questions. I know I can come across as a little bit of a hard ass, but that's intentional because you will learn on this channel more than you will learn anywhere else. But you guys got to ask me questions if you want to learn as much as you can. So what is queer? queer is a far left political ideology that is specifically designed to abolish the gender binary. The gender binary is men and women. So when you're seeing people running around saying they're a they, them, or a he, they, or a she, they, or any other pronouns that are not she, her, or he, his, that is a reference to the queer ideology, because non-binary literally means no binary. It is very important that people understand that queer is not about being gay or trans. You can quite literally be a straight, cisgendered white man and still identify as queer. Queer is just about saying you're queer. And what the goal of queer really is to destabilize destabilize normativity. Normativity is anything that upholds capitalism and the nuclear family. That's why they're going after the gender binary, because they believe capitalism, which is defined as private property ownership, created the gender binary, which put men in the workplace, women in the home. Putting women in the home, doing the unpaid labor of raising the nuclear family, created the nuclear family in the first place, which is another thing that upholds capitalism. It is not a Gnostic sex cult. No matter how many books James Lindsay writes saying it's a Gnostic sex cult, he is wrong. It's only and exclusively about abolishing the gender binary, because they believe they will not achieve gender equity until they get rid of men and women. Does that make sense? Let me know.
Like lifelines, like you said, with like text, Snapchat, because that's what's, well, accessible, right? And no matter time or day or weekend or not, they're able to communicate with their peers. Whereas going to school, you know, they see them for a little bit of time, and that can be great or awful. So what we see is that that's a consistent communication method for them as well. So it's, how are we making systems in a place that's safe to communicate, but also accessible? Because so many things are limited to virtual for these youth, because there aren't a lot of spaces to go. So a lot of like social like areas aren't always affirming. They're not always safe.
Dog Whistle Daniel says, would it be accurate to say that communists believe there is no boundaries in anything, even cultural? Well, boundaries are a sign of upholding capitalism. And so, yeah, I mean, I don't think they believe in boundaries for anything. But even more important than boundaries is what you need to understand. Communists do not believe in hierarchies. So the hierarchies are actually the problem, because hierarchies are caused by individualism. Hierarchies are caused by meritocracy. You cannot have a society built on equity and have a hierarchy in which some people have access to more resources than the other. I don't know that I would say boundaries equal hierarchy, because I think it is slightly different and slightly nuanced. But the hierarchy are the things that they want to eliminate. New slime drop bot. I just got the text.
So that limits their ability to go out and do things in the community that otherwise, like, their cisgender peers could. So it's really about changing that. And I really like that question a lot. And I wish I had more of a definitive answer. And that's something that I know a lot of research is going into, and a lot of people are talking about. So I hope to continue to be part of that conversation, and I encourage others to.
Oh, I got a different slime.
But yeah, that's essentially my take on it, but I would love to hear other people's takes too, because I think that we could all have a lot of input on that, because we all have different experiences with these youth. And then the affirmation of these identities are showing that rates of mental health and suicidality are lower when these affirmations occur. Right. Again, it goes into self-worth, self-belonging, acceptance, safety.
Well, AMC over on Rumble has said, I thought the queer were just the ones that got into the movement a few years ago. Lesbian, gay, bisexual, and transgender were there first. Yes, they were. But what you need to know is that after gay marriage was legalized, queer Marxist, because that's what this is. Anything queer is just Marxism, okay? Queer Marxist came in and hijacked the LGBT rights movement. So, like, once gay marriage was done, a lot of LGBT people were like, okay, we're good now. We just want to live normal lives. Like, leave us alone. We just want to be able to get married and have benefits. That was it, really. And so a lot of those people left the movement. Queer Marxists came in and hijacked the movement, which is why they control it today.
So many versions of affirmation create that sense of belonging, that sense of self and sense of worth, right? When we have people affirming us and really validating and seeing us as who we are, it gives us worth because we're part of the world. And what we see in youth is that when they are a part of the world and they're affirmed in who they are, their suicidality lowers because those negative impacts with like depression and anxiety of constant hypervigilance and all of that is lowering. So it's, we're lowering the rates of suicidality. And by affirming them, we're reducing these negative mental health outcomes, which is in turn also reducing our suicidality rate. And this is definitely non-comprehensive and it's still relatively basic, but some ways to validate identity is pronouns. One, ask them and honor them. I think it's important too to realize that sometimes part of the conversation is us as adults, right? We can honor pronouns, but do we ever ask, right? Do we ever? And obviously there's so many awkward ways and limited ways to ask, but sometimes even just asking or introducing ourselves with our own pronouns gives that safe space to not only present their pronouns, but also gives a way to always have it out there to be honored. And then normalize asking names. So even just within cisgender youth as well, not everybody goes by their given name, their first name even. I know children who go by their middle names or a nickname. So in general, this is a great thing to ask, but especially with transgender and gender diverse populations, because they may not otherwise have a space to introduce themselves with that name. And we don't want to unintentionally validate their experience by calling them a name that's not theirs. And then I see two questions. I promise I will get to them in just a second. And just normalize asking that, because as a default, it's a great way to just affirm anybody and really basic respect, right? I know that I wouldn't like to be called a name that's not mine. And somebody asking me really validates the fact that they really want to know who I am. They really want to know who I am, what I am, like in terms of like, what am I about? And so by giving my name and pronouns and being asked those things is a great way to share that in a safe way. And then holding space to be safe and explore. Identity and gender is an ever-evolving process. There's no A to B with transition. Our identities, I believe that as we come out with new words and new ways to identify, we really resonate with those things. And we continue to find better ways to describe ourselves to really explain to others who we are. And part of that for youth is incredibly important because they're already just trying to figure out who they are as like a teenager, a youth, and navigating the world in that whole development. So then to add on the additional like trying to figure out who they are with their identity, with their like expression and every part of it, of being transgender in this society, is an added complication, an added journey, an added like stressor. So for us as adults to hold that space for them to not only be safe in who they are, but also be safe to explore it is incredibly important. It's a great way to validate identity because there may be times where that isn't a space that they have otherwise and they really don't get to know who they are. Okay, so it looks like Christy said, how can families and caregivers best support and learn alongside youth who are looking to begin hormone treatment as part of their transition journey? That's a really great question. So hormone treatment, it can get a little tricky with youth, mainly because there's a lot of system factors within that, right? Hormones, and more so than not, we're seeing youth that are using hormone blockers, right? They're blocking different hormones from coming through as they're reaching like prepubescent like hormone stages, right? We're trying to block those hormones to limit that transition of like actual pubescent. But it can get really tricky within that, because you also have to think about finding a provider that is willing to do that, is willing to work and learn alongside you essentially on how to do that. And unfortunately, those providers are few and far between. The system has not set up to give that information to a lot of medical professionals as they're going through school. There's not a lot of education. And then you run into personal beliefs as well. And the liability, unfortunately, there have been a lot of
personal beliefs.
Laws being passed to do so many things to penalize providers from providing affirmative, like transitional care to youth, which really, really changes the aspect.
Oh no, Jan! Oh no!
So I think that's really part of the journey, is really finding a way to have access to that care, in which unfortunately there isn't a lot. Some people also find issues with providers accepting insurance and having a lot of those also barriers. But a best way that a caregiver can like really learn alongside these youth, right? Looking at research, looking at experiences, this youth is finding this information, and the internet is a great place to do that. So really taking the time to learn with them, looking for those resources, listening to the community, and really looking at what that transitional journey could look like based on like their age, their ability, how they want to transition into who they are. So I guess my best advice is, well, what you already said, to learn alongside them. And then like Michelle said, how would you respond to someone who says, I don't do pronouns? Well, and perfect fashion, I am snarky. I would be like, I don't do you not doing pronouns, because that's not acceptable to me. Obviously, a youth isn't going to do that because of power dynamics, and most people aren't as snarky as me. And I guess my best response too is, why? Because really, I want to know why. Is it that we don't truly understand pronouns? Is it that we aren't educated on it? And is it just trying to be a butthead, or just really opposing a belief in a rooted belief that they have or that they've been taught? And I've had conversations like this with people, right? I've experienced many of people who say that I don't do pronouns. And a lot of it is, I want to know why, because if I can have the why, there may be a conversation I can have to be like, okay, well, I can see where you're coming from in terms of, I understand the thought process, but like, let's see how it looks in this process, right? Like, how are we going to have that talk? And then kind of added on to this too, is that I've had extended family members say that in reference to my child, and honestly, I'm offended by it, as if it negated my child's experience in reality. Yes. At that, absolutely. Yeah. It's very unaffirmative, right? It's somebody telling somebody that their experiences in reality aren't valid. They're not real. That having a way to explore who you are isn't it. It's not it. And that can be really unaffirmative, and it's offensive, right?
This is the beginning of a struggle session. You're right.
To tell somebody how they choose to identify or how they choose to express themselves. And I really think asking for that elaboration is really great, because like you said, kind of that they may not understand what pronouns are. And that's really great, because sometimes we have to meet people where we're at and where they're at, and we have to.
I love it when new people come on the channel. Because freedom, this is like, for me, this is kind of like, I'm not even surprised by any of this anymore. But I love it when new people come on the channel because they keep me honest and they're like, this is fucking crazy. And I'm like, bro, I watch this like 6 days a week. Like, this is not even new. But it is actually good because I'm way desensitized to this stuff now. And so I really do ask that, especially the new people, keep me honest with what you think is crazy and what's blowing your mind, because it might be something that I've heard literally hundreds of times before. And freedom, just keep coming back, bro. Keep coming. You think this is crazy? Yo. We've got a lot more to show you, bro.
Come together and find something. And sometimes it's just not going to happen, unfortunately, that we're not going to be able to meet a middle ground and work from there. Some people just don't get it or don't want to get it. And that's just kind of where that is. And it's really just comes down to why don't you do pronouns? And that's, yeah. And it looks like we've got about 15 minutes. So I promise there's some discussion components of it. Ideally, the discussion components would go with mics, but I don't know if that's a thing that can happen.
It's very tame.
I am not tech savvy.
Very tame. That's a good thing, you know? Good thing.
Okay, perfect. We do have a way.
If a presentation doesn't seem crazy to us, that's actually a really good thing, right? Because it's like, I was like, oh, the influencers, no! Why do the influencers fuck everything up? Who's fighting? Who is trying to destroy this opportunity? God damn the fucking influencers. The influencers suck so bad. Anyway, it's a good thing when presentations are like, eh, that could have been a lot worse.
Thank you.
Oh, so Ben and Candace are fighting?
Technical
okay.
people, because I am not. Again, kind of like, what does this all mean? Let's talk about what these numbers mean and how they impact our everyday lives.
Oh, they want to... Okay.
So let's actually have a discussion about this.
So what's happening now is that Candace has replied to Ben saying, I'm sure you can appreciate why I'd prefer to keep this off the Daily Wire platform. I mean, Candace actually has a good point there. As well as the true reason why we were never able to make any discussion happen. Let's vote a neutral, trustworthy platform. I vote Patrick Bet David. And then Ben said, Candace, I can see why you'd want to hide behind a moderator, particularly one who said we should rename our company the Daily Jewish Wire yesterday. No, one-on-one, Monday at 5 p.m. We can sit down and have a healthy debates like adults. I hope it happens. Candace should just do it.
It's like, sorry, that was like the title. Like, I'm going to throw more information at you. Nope, this is, we're actually going to talk.
Can we just do it?
Anybody
please?
Can jump in. You can either type in the chat or unmute your mics. I can't see a lot of the chats, so... excuse me if I don't see it, so I'm sorry. So the first question is, after hearing this information that you did today with me, what was your first thought after hearing that?
Just a quick note to everybody to join the discussion. You can't actually unmute, but what you can do is just post in the chat that you have a comment, and I will add you onto the stage really quickly, and then you'll be able to unmute that way. So just post in the chat if you'd like to speak. Thank you.
We don't. Sorry. Okay. We can't. Right now.
Looks like Emily would like to speak.
Can y'all hear me?
Yep.
Yes, Emily.
Okay, great. You know, what I took from this presentation was we need to be advocating in more creative ways, especially when we're thinking about mental health and working in these systems. I know there was a lot of data that was presented and a lot of unfortunate statistics. So, you know, we're having these conversations, but how do we move forward? How do we advocate, you know, fully for these youth who are, you know, these are might be their darkest days that they're living through, and how do we get them?
Yeah, congratulations, power's back.
You know, this isn't my first conversation or, you know, webinar where I've talked about non-binary and trans folks. And so it's just, you know, continuing. I'm so glad so many people are here, but just how do we go forward? How can we each do our part to make sure that these kids, you know, grow up to be adults and are having the services they need? Thank you so much, Skylar.
Yeah. And I 100% agree that this is definitely a continuing conversation and we need more creative ways to do that. And I do actually talk about that, not today in this presentation, but that is a thing that I have presented to you on is how do we keep the conversation going? How do we get creative to continue to evolve with society, really? Like said earlier, the age of technology.
It's Sophie's birthday? How did I not know it was Sophie's birthday? Oh my God. Hey God. How did I not know it was Sophie's birthday? Did Sophie block me again on Twitter? Oh my God, I forgot my online girlfriend's birthday. I would be like, happy birthday, Sophie. We love you. God, I've had a busy day, Reagan, okay? I haven't been keeping up with every message that everyone's been sending me. So finally, Benny is going to debate someone who isn't a woke college kids for a change. I feel the Daily Wire is going to split. Funnily enough, Walsh is also against military aid for Israel. Is he next? No, because Walsh isn't saying he's against Israel. He's just saying she's against military aid. Yes, I knew Sophie was an Aries. This is why Sophie secretly likes me. Sophie might deny that she likes me, but Sophie secretly likes me because Sophie is an Aries too. I knew that. All right, I'm wishing Sophie a happy birthday.
Has changed a lot of things for our youth. And how are we as professionals outside of that, helping them to, as you said, become adults and be more well-adjusted and less negative mental health outcomes?
I have a question / comment, Skylar. Can you hear me?
Yep.
I was wondering, and this came up in the chat a little bit. I was wondering about your thoughts on some of those ways to be a better advocate that Emily talked about. And
can't believe it's Sophie's birthday.
The backlash that I've seen around this is, you know, people use rhetoric like, you know, being transgender is like a trend or fashionable. Or, I mean, just and on and on and on. I mean, there's a lot. I don't want to repeat any of it. But I'm just, in my experience and my knowledge and my learning around this, like there's so much information just about basic science and human development that people just don't know. There's a reason that people think there's only two biological sexes and that because that's all that people were ever taught just en masse.
What?
And that's my take
there
on it.
Is.
And so I'm just wondering about your thoughts on the value to try to expand people's.
There are people who think there are only two biological sexes because that's all they were ever taught. There's a reason for that.
Understanding of just the basics, like the kind of like gender identity 101. Like we're talking about kind of much more intensive, in-depth, like statistics and things, but like, how does a parent who's never heard this word before, doesn't understand what it means to be non-binary, like what are those like basic kind of public education things that you've seen work in the past in terms of like messaging or framing around this that we can all kind of take with us and use in our communities that might resonate with people around like why this is, you know, trans people have been around forever. It's just, we're only just now talking about it. I can understand that there's a real dissonance there. So it's like, how do you address that kind of piece of the puzzle?
Yeah. Sorry, my voice cracked. I think it's really important to have those conversations and really bring them down to the basics. There's a lot of presenters out there, a lot of the community that really find ways to talk about the basics and bring that education. And there's also some really great online and organizational information. So like the Trevor Project, GLAAD, HRC, like Human Rights Campaign, and so many more. I could probably spend an entire hour listing off places that have really great community resources or really great education resources. And a lot of it does come down to the lack of education. Like you said, trans people have been around for a very long time. So it's not new. It's not a fad. It's just, like you said, we are just starting to talk about it. It's just starting to become a conversation that has becoming a larger conversation. And so we have folks coming in.
Well, do you know why Libby follows her? Because Libby started to dabble in abolish the family stuff very briefly. And then we started tweeting at Libby on Twitter about Sophie. Like, that was one of many things we started tweeting at Libby about. I briefly unblocked Libby because I find Libby to be an insufferable cunt. So I block her on Twitter. But I briefly unblocked her to educate her about abolish the family. And I think that was when she followed Sophie. I'm sure it was just a coincidence. Sophie doesn't post anything fun on Twitter anyway. All of Sophie's stuff is in video.
With really no education because it was never brought to them. It was never taught. It's never been presented. And so I think really the best things we can do is continue to just even put that basic information out there and encourage like more educational talks out there. A lot of times in formats like this, it's really great to come together with other people who may be wanting to learn the same and even having conversations together so that we can continue to process and learn education so that we can carry it out with us. So I really think that there's a benefit in making resources for knowledge as well, like just easily accessible everywhere. And as well as having a place for folks in the community to also have those opinions out, because that's the best way to learn. And so you can really answer any of these questions. I'm not going to just, I promise, go 1, 2, 3, 4 to answer them. We've got about 5 more minutes. So really just, it's an open platform for us to have discussion or really just share any takeaways or ways you think that the discussion can continue after leaving here today. I'm going to take the, oh, there we go. I was like, I'm going to take the lack of as like, we're good, but I see one now.
Becky Queen from Oklahoma, Health, Family and Children Services, Oklahoma. What does Becky want to ask?
Am I on?
Hello, Becky.
Did that work?
I can hear you.
Holy moly. Okay, there we go. So my question, and I came in a little later than I was anticipating, so I apologize for that. However, if you answered this, I apologize, but I am trying to raise 2 children in such a way that, and this is personal and also professional, in such a way that it's that they are allies and that they are a safe space as well. And having those conversations with a 7 and a 9-year-old can be problematic sometimes. So I am trying to get y'all's opinion on how best to
raising
do that.
Good allies. good allies.
Yeah, absolutely.
Exactly. Ally means comrade.
Didn't say too much about that, but
ally
I think that
is a precursor to comrade.
Hard to have those discussions too when we think about development of those ages too. But also learning a way to present it as an age appropriate thing. There's some really great resources out there of like age appropriate books, age appropriate like content out there to kind of help guide in those conversations, because you're right, this is a lot to digest. It's a lot to take in as an adult, as well as then adolescents. But how do we really break it down to younger children, because they're developmentally have a different like perception of the world?
Mm-hmm.
And so really it's just, I think a great way is those resources, 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 resources. I am huge on resources.
Same.
There's some really great, there's some really great books out there that really like bring it down to a concept that children that age can understand.
Excellent. And I don't know, just kind of FYI, I don't know if anybody else knows this, but there is, have y'all ever heard of Little People, Big World books? There's one on RuPaul now. So that was one of the resources that we've been using, and we're just kind of very open, and we don't necessarily hide anything. But like you said, kind of putting it down into what a 7 and a 9-year-old can understand. So I appreciate you talking to me about that.
Absolutely. And then just as we, oh, it looks like we have somebody that also wants to talk.
Okay, can you hear me yet? This, my camera is on. Well, let's see, is my microphone.
Yes, I can hear you now. There's like a lag.
Okay. Yeah, I was wondering. So I have a 7 and a 9-year-old. I'm a foster parent. I also have a 12, 15, 16,
good.
And 19-year-olds.
Oh, good.
And my 15 and 16-year-olds both currently identify as trans.
Of
and
course
so it
they do.
Definitely has sparked a lot of conversations. And so my 9-year-old recently had said, you know, that they do identify as a gender different than the one that they were born with.
Oh my God.
And I do think it's helpful to have those conversations about.
I think it's just a massive coincidence that three children within the same foster fucking parent family all identify as trans. A massive, massive coincidence.
Because I remember at 12 starting to identify as cis, or, you know, like recognizing that I was cisgender. I didn't have the words at that time, but knowing that being female felt right, even if I didn't want to shave my armpits, even if I didn't want to do the social constructs of it, that it still was something that felt right. And so then it's been interesting watching my 9-year-old process it and then do it within a school context and within the context of family. But just having those conversations about what does it feel like in your body, you know, whenever you think about being a mom, or if you think about being a dad, or if you think about ways of being. And I've struggled because I was raised where like girls can do anything and boys can do anything. And so part of me wants to be like, well, you can be female and still do anything. You know, but it is a different conversation that we are having these days. And I definitely, I mean, I'm supportive of my kids, and that's why I've gotten kids from other less supportive areas who are like 2 and 3 hours away from where they're from to get placed with me so they can be in a supportive home, but still just figuring out how to have those conversations. And it is difficult, and balancing other mental health issues that, you know, a lot of my kiddos have going on, and ways to feel supportive and to have conversations and for there not to be a right or a wrong way. But I had also posted in the chat, there was the FedEx delivery person had tattoos all over her body. And I had noticed really? That I thought she was trans. And so I was asking about the tattoos and she was like, yeah, it opens up conversations because these are all animals in nature that are gender diverse, that, you know, like we're turtles or frogs where their gender can change based.
She got a body full of tattoos of gender diverse queer biology animals. Let's listen to that again.
But I had also posted in the chat, there was the FedEx delivery person had tattoos all I over bet her you body. They, and
I bet you they were all black line tattoos. That
I thought she was trans.
I bet you they were.
And so I was asking about the tattoos and she was like, yeah, it opens up conversations because these are all animals in nature that are gender diverse, that, you know, like we're turtles or frogs where their gender can change based on temperatures and based on the needs of the society. So I was really impressed. You know, that she was willing in our not completely rural, but, you know, wow. I live in the Midwest. It's not the most affirming place, you know, that she was willing to put her.
Guys, by the way, if you don't think they're teaching queer biology in school, then what I need you to do is I need you to Google queer biology because they are teaching it in school. They're teaching it to your kids. I have a video about queer biology. I covered it at one point. I wrote an article on my Substack about queer biology. Queer biology is a real thing.
Yourself out there through these tattoos and through starting those conversations. So it's definitely an ongoing conversation, but there's ways to do it even with the 7 and the 9-year-olds for sure.
Yeah, absolutely. Someone said that's an awesome tattoo idea, and I definitely agree that
it was very cool.
It's an awful tattoo idea.
Awesome. Well,
all right, it looks like they're about to wrap up, but let me just grab this super chat from Naruto real quick. I know we're all shocked that a Manosphere conservative influencer would pressure his girlfriend to abort their unborn child in a virtual recording. Yeah, that fresh and fit asshole. I know we're all shocked that men in the Manosphere are having indiscriminate sex with women they barely know and then getting them pregnant and then telling them to have an abortion. I know that was shocking information to all of us, but, you know, it is what it is.
Well, I think we are at time. I can't see the clock, but I'm going to assume.
Just going to wait and see. There's a couple minutes left in the presentation. Maybe they got one more in.
Yes. And there is, like Suki just put in the chat, that there is a second from the bottom icon to complete that a survey. And it looks like you'll get some points.
Yes, yes. Remember, we are doing
good. All right. They are indeed wrapping up. No, we cannot watch it again. That was a relatively boring presentation, honestly. It's honestly a good thing when it's a relatively boring presentation. I like relatively boring presentations. Relatively boring presentations mean there's nothing to effing worry about. Well, I mean, that's not to say there's nothing to worry about. Of course, it's not good that our taxpayer dollars are being used to fund that thing, but it could have been a lot worse. Anyway, guys, that's all we have for today. As we conclude, make sure you head over to my Substack, which is Carlyn, carlyn.substack.com. Make sure you are signed up for free email updates. And if you do want to support the work I'm doing, which I greatly, greatly appreciate, you can sign up for $8 a month or $80 a year. I am completely 100% grassroots funded by you. And so this stuff doesn't continue if you guys don't sign up to fund it. And I do post all my best stuff on my Substack, to include clips, to include independent journalism, undercover journalism, stuff like that. And of course, make sure you sign up for the How to Speak Socialist trainings. If you've never been to one of my How to Speak Socialist trainings before, you need to sign up for both of them. If you've already signed up, if you've already been to one of mine previously, you don't need to sign up for the first one, but you should sign up for the second one. These are live private webinars that are going to be happening on April 18th, April 25th. They will be recorded. So if you want to sign up and get access to a recording, even if you can't make it live, definitely head over to the Substack and do that. I will be back tomorrow for Socialism Saturday at 6 p.m. Take care, guys. Have a good rest of your night. We'll see you soon. Bye.